thanks, Joan, for inviting us. We really appreciate being able to bring the work into a really wonderful space. It's a wonderful gallery, and I think every place that one shows, one looks at one's own work differently. So thank you. Want to say anything?
Yeah. Joan's invitation for us to come and show jointly was interesting because we spend so much time together. We teach at the same school. We're married to each other. We share studios side by side, and we've shown together. We did a collaboration show at UMass 1 year when we were asked to make work on the same surfaces together, either consecutively or concurrently, and that kind of fused identity that we have as is interesting, and sometimes the source of great joy, and sometimes the source of some friction. So it's interesting to try and sort that out once again, and make work that works well together and yet has its own presence. For myself, I was interested in altering the space. That was my first idea when I saw the space, and I was going to use the striped maples, which I've used in other circumstances in other galleries, to either in bundles or in stacks or to change the space. I was interested in the rectangle of the light fixtures, and I was going to do something more aggressive to the space by following its edges or coming this way and as well as this way with the striped maples. But after thinking about that collaborative nature of the show and the work that we were going to show together, it became really interruptive to what would have been Cathy's challenges then of having to the space. So the idea changed somewhat, and instead of this being a fully three-dimensional experience, it became much more of a kind of space creation device. This gallery being kind of a three-walled gallery, I was interested in creating the fourth wall. I was interested in making a wall off of which objects could work. The objects themselves are made of clay, and they have they're dipped in roofing tar. Clay had been my original sculptural medium years ago at Rhode Island School of Design, and I had largely stopped using it until very recently, until about a year ago, when I made a pyramidal sculpture that had many, many sculptures, little ones, on top of it that were in kind of rings up above. And Martina Lanton, who is here, our ceramics teacher at Marlboro, taught me how to use a surface called terra sigillata, which is a beautiful, refined clay surface, which when it's fired on, gives a really taut and interesting surface tension to the sculptures. I was thinking about doing that, but then I was talking to one of our other students who was looking for an interesting surface, and she asked me for some suggestions, and I said, "What about roofing tar?" And then I realized what an interesting idea that might be for my sculptures as well. So roofing tar is all the rage at Marlboro College right now, right at the moment. the forms are you know, using the wall maybe, but not really integrated with it. I think the wall alters the way that you experience the space. It has a relationship to some of the linear work that Cathy's doing in her collages. And it certainly has something to do with the two erasure drawings that I have in the show as well. I have two drawings from earlier date where jumbles of forms are gathered together, and out of which I will look for forms that might coalesce into an actual sculpture in that corner and this corner. But also two drawings that are more directly related to these bundles of moosewood sculptures that I've been making that have to do with the simple linearity of tree trunks, of striped maple is a succession tree. It grows in the forest after the loggers have been there or after a fire. It comes in, it fills in quickly. It likes the shade, so it survives in complicated environments with lots of other big trees. They never grow very big, and they're very open structure. They're quite soft, but they're really beautiful. They make big tulip-shaped leaves. They're just gorgeous trees, and they're all over our property, and so they've been a kind of natural working material for me. But that's enough for me.
The body of work that's on the wall is coming off of, I guess, about 4 years now, 5 years, where I really haven't been working as a painter, even though that was the language that I used was oil paint on canvas. And I, over time, have kind of migrated from different kinds of surfaces, which oil paint, non-traditional surfaces, so plastic I would paint on, I'd paint on drafting vellums, and kind of over time I kept sort of returning to paper and the flexibility of paper, the way in which paper can be pre-printed or pre-marked or given a kind of identity before you even begin to build with it. And my earliest artistic practice was actually as a sculptor, and which for me was additive, an additive process where I was adding things, taking them off, adding, taking off, and that's always informed kind of the way that I build images. So even as a painter, it was a mark upon mark, covered up mark, another mark, and through that process of covering up, revealing, adding, I'd start to build an image or a kind of history, if you will, to the work. I think of this work very much like drawing. I think its closest relationship is to some of those formal properties around drawing. So mark, sort of rhythm, density, transparency, to sort of establish a kind of pictorial relationship. The work has always had direct influence from my natural surroundings, or I won't exactly say the landscape, because that kind of puts the world outside us into a more pastoral, but I am always been informed by location, about the sort of rhythms and textures of the landscape. This work is really also in response to some travels that both Tim and I have been on to Southeast Asia. And earlier to that is sort of Chinese brush painting, the way in which a mark can hold information without having a sort of set of representational associations. The use of paper throughout Southeast Asia is so rich and has such an identity that for years and years, I've tried to find a way that I could use a rice paper, I could use paper with respect to that tradition, but also to somehow kind of make it my own. So many of these, less so in this particular body of work, but I'm using sewing pattern material, rice papers, found materials that I pre-print. I like the work of working. So I like to set myself up with tasks in order to sort of open up a conversation with how that image is gonna come together. So I'll just have a printing press and I'll do tons and tons of mono printing. And if I just sort of use this, for example, these are onion skins that I printed onto paper. This is a little stamp that I went over and stamped everything. So most all of this work doesn't have my direct hand in it at all. So if I use that association to drawing, where your hand is ever present, my hand is kind of mediated between this printed material beforehand, and then I build with it as if I were back using my paintbrush or my hand. I like chaos. I like sort of creating a chaotic, complex, multi-layered situation, and then try to find an order within that, whether it be a linear order or a density order. I like that engagement with my own sort of tip the kettle over and then try to get all the pieces back in again in some new organization. The content of the work, you know, this piece, just because it's closest to us, is very much about a kind of industrialization of the landscape. I guess, if I were to put a, you know, something direct and what I was thinking about. It's titled Oil Rigs. But again, I'm not really imaging specifically that. Most of the work has a kind of aerial quality, as if we were up and above, thinking about mapping and connectivity. The piece behind you is speaking to a relationship that Tim and I have to a small school in Cambodia. So a lot of this bridging that I'm doing had some of its origins in thinking about a bridging between our two cultures, the fragility of those bridges. There's some text in there, which is speak English, learn English, sort of my relationship with the difficulty of what that means. How do you bridge my culture to another culture, the expectation they should learn English. So a lot of the, I guess, the netting or the trying to enclose things has something to do with that, kind of, you know, pulling things together. But then it's also what I like to do. I like to make that shape. You know, it's pretty, it doesn't have to get more complex than that. It's just a shape I like. I used to like ovals a lot. You know, I liked sort of the lily pad shape. Now I like this shape. So there's something that's pretty matter of fact about that. This sort of coming off the wall, I think, is coming back to my sculptural roots a bit. I'm still a little bit unsure of, you know, really coming very far off the wall in terms of additive on a flat two-dimensional piece. These are all back into the rectangle. The last body of work I did, I sort of broke open that square and had it be more sculptural on the wall. I think I'm more comfortable in the rectangle after my long history as a painter. I guess the materials are really important to me. Having something be physical, the surface be alive. Seems if you guys are willing, because it's not a slideshow, the work is here in front of us, I'd be really interested in having questions rather than my telling you. I think I would be most interested in having hear from all of you relative to the work and some ideas that are coming out of the work itself and ways that we can sort of share it rather than, you know, be more in a performance mode. So, are there thoughts that you guys have? Yeah.
You were talking about a bridge.
A bridge?
Yeah. And what do you think about networks as a different metaphor?
I think that's a good metaphor. Links, networks, that kind of tracking that goes on, also that happens, you know, say an aerial mapping, how things move, nothing is sort of not connected, right? There's a continual connection, but they're always breaking and reforming. So that's pretty important, yeah. Where over here, that one seems more like a bridge, right? The tension lines are pulling through the landscape and then bridging. Where certainly the one to the left is more of that netting and breaking nets and sort of layering in a circular way, but also expanding and contracting.
This question is for both of you, and I think it might mean different things, but how do you begin a piece?
For me, it differs greatly whether I'm working in two dimensions or three. In two dimensions, I think I'm more allowing stuff to happen, seeing what goes on, and then finding something within it. In three dimensions, I pretty much have made some choices beforehand, and I have a form in mind, or a posture in mind, or a sense of balance in mind, some relationship to gravity, some relationship to what's inside and what's outside. And so I'll start in making something that has that three-dimensional idea contained within it. But I think once I'm drawing, I'm more open to accidents and discoveries. It's not to say that odd things don't happen in the midst of making the sculpture where I'll take a right angle turn. But I've worked with sheet materials for a long time, either sheets of clay or sheets of steel or sheets of wire mesh or sheets of waxed paper. And cutting up sheets is where I always seem to start. I don't model necessarily, I don't carve, but I start with sheets of flat materials that are varying thicknesses, varying translucencies. And in that way, I think Cathy and I have a lot in common, because I think she starts with sheet materials too, a lot. Papers mostly, but canvases and different kinds of materials too. And notions of scale, is it going to be a little one or a big one? I start there.
I really am pretty process. So as I work, ideas unfold. I keep going to this one, but it's the oldest one, but this was a completely different piece when I started, and it was very much in relationship to losing a parent, right? I mean, it really was very like, I have to make all those red things because, I was in this distraught place, but it went way out of that place. I mean, it completely changed into this industrial landscape. But I know what was under there, and I know that process of getting somewhere. I think, for me right now, it's producing this raw material to begin with, which has maybe a color, a density, that then we'll say that'll be a landscape versus something that's going to be very linear. But I try to hang on to an initial idea, but it floats really quickly away from that. I had a series of paintings which I said were pond-based. And they all were. They had something that connected them in terms of the surface of water, what's under the water, what's above the water. But it wasn't really direct, like this one will be this. There was an ongoing vocabulary, I guess, that links them. And that comes from lots of years of working, too, where I have this vocabulary that either I use or I try to kind of break it. This is getting redundant. I'm just making this diamond shape because it's redundant and it no longer has associations to what I want it to. So then I try to unravel rather than perhaps be really overt with my subject matter at the time. I feel like I fail when I get too bound in subject matter or it falls short.
But I'm assuming that you gather an enormous amount of information, materials, before you work, Cathy in this case.
Yeah.
And therefore they can go in various kinds of delineated boxes or places. And would you speak to the issue, especially for students, of the kind of information that's necessary to gather to work with things such as you are ahead of time? Because you can't
right.
start easily without having materials to work with.
I think
it might be an elongated period of time before an actual piece needs to take place. I hear the difference in the planning. But they're just the sheer gathering of information, fluid material that you can use.
Yeah, I think that's really the thinking process too, is just, that piece to your left there was printed off of a wood block, a series of wood blocks that I did years ago that I never was satisfied with, so I just printed them again and again and again and again and again and again. And in doing that, I started to change color. Things started to transform. And then from there, I had ideas that were building through that without having to be specific at that time. And I think that's the best way that I find myself working now. It allows me into the studio. It takes some of that pressure that painters often experience, right? Oh, that mark. Nope. Oh, that was wrong. I can just be in this working mode and be building a kind of momentum unbeknownst to my own sort of self-consciousness around it, if that makes any sense.
Can I ask Tim quickly?
Yeah.
When you said you deliberate quite a while about a piece, how does that deliberation take place?
Usually through drawing. Yeah, usually through drawing. From one of these more complicated drawings, I'll start to draw from the drawing until I find a starting shape, and I'll say, oh, that's an interesting shape, and then I'll go and cut that out of a piece of the whatever sheet it is that I'm working from, and start to manipulate it, bend it, change it, find the right pieces to go with it. It's usually through drawing. Sometimes it's just looking. Sometimes I'll look into something and say, oh, if I make this shape, then I have the start of something.
I'm also concerned about, do you look at a piece like you have of a wood, the piece is horizontal, and say, how do you render new pieces from that idea still stay in the same category?
Yeah. Well, that's clearly the tendency of an awful lot of artists to stay on a topic for a while, in my case for a very long while, for some of my forms, but because I can recognize the seed of some of the these figures on the table from work that I've done many years ago. So, I mean, yes, that happens. This kind of work is newer to me, so I'm just sort of just figuring out how to use this simple unit of a sapling in a lot of different ways.
I was wondering if you could speak a little bit to when, at what time did you guys decide that you wanted to make art, and what that was about, and how school might relate to that?
I think we were both very fortunate in that regard, in that we didn't go through a crisis about that. We knew early on we wanted to be artists. We started being artists when we were beginning college students, and it didn't seem like there was any impediment to that. That may have been our foolhardiness, but our forms of art have shifted, but I think, isn't that right?
Yeah, I mean, high school, I took a ceramics class and I was so happy, making stuff. I also, I was kind of a hippie. I made like leather shoes and stuff. I tried to weave, I hated that. But it was like using my hands that I realized pretty early on that I liked that. But I went to undergraduate school not knowing what I was going to be. And then it really just kind of, those were the places I felt most comfortable, was in that dialogue and making art. But I was really romantic, and I guess I still am, about the way in which we bring art into our life and take it out of our life too. That, we moved to New York City. We thought we were going to, be artists.
I was joking with some friends at dinner the other night that it's really been sort of like a 40-year detour. Art, okay, we'll go and do that. Maybe we'll wise up one of these days. I was telling Martina, my friend Martina, that I had started recently writing again, some poetical writing that probably was my first art form, and one that I'm still sort of struggling with the decision for having left it behind in favor of visual art, in favor of sculpture, and the things that I did choose to do. And so I was kind of wondering if that some turn of events might take me back to where I should have been all these years. But I don't know. It's a terribly hard decision. I don't mean to make light of it, because we deal with it with students all the time too. I think I was talking to Zoe about it the other day. It's like, are you going to be an artist when, it's like, oh, I don't think so. And, but there's that, it's an implicit choice that you make. You put all this effort into it, and it's out there as both a risk and an invitation. I'm sorry to single you out.
It's not without constant questions, though. I think we're not over it yet, sort of questioning the right. That which we do and the merits of it. And, I think having this balance of being teachers and artists is a good one. I mean, it allows this dialogue that is continuing, that it's continuing for myself in terms of my own methodologies. If I didn't have that, I don't know. It'd be really hard. That is our community, and it's a good one. But it's not. We're not bound by making a living by our art either. We've had the pleasure, if you will, or the leeway to make work that isn't very archival, or ultimately lives on walls like this, and perhaps not in a commercial market. And that's a big difference than people that we know who really are trying to balance the budget, the books on their own work, and that's tough. It puts a very different pressure onto the equation.
I guess I'd just like to hear a little more about your relationship to form and content, in particular with Tim, how the choice of materials that you assemble together, how those speak to your thoughts on just the formal qualities, or how you also want that to reflect content. And with Cathy, you talk about your work in the building of the pieces. You talk about the things you're experiencing and thinking about throughout the time, the duration that you're putting into the piece. But then I wonder, in the end, how much do you care whether your viewers have any idea about that content, or is it really just for inspiration while you're making?
You know, I've always thought of my sculptures as being characters. Are they figures? Are they architectures? Are they specific? No, I don't think so. But I think of them as being animate things in some way, not formal relationships. More like, how do I imbue this form with a sense of life, a sense of balance, a sense of gesture, a sense of it being present as a thing that which is alive, or refers to things which we all can respond to in that way. I've never made, is that not never, but rarely made work that is topical, with the exception of a series of pieces that I made that were called Armed. If Joan asked us if we wanted to have a slide projector here today, and we decided not to, but it would allow me to show this piece, which was very topically related. It was after the first Gulf War, and which was such, if you all remember, was such a one-sided war. There was a terrible kind of slaughter in as the Iraqis retreated from Kuwait, and the resulting convoy of destruction was in the desert, and the images of it were tremendously moving. I made a series of sculptures that were directly about that. And so occasionally, I have tried to be topical, but most often not. Most often I'm after this sort of key in people as I make something that allows them to recognize an animate and lively, sometimes humorous, sometimes dire character in front of them. So I think that's probably much more consistent for me than work that has a kind of nameable topic.
When I've tried really overtly to start with content, for instance this piece, or even the one behind Joan, where I said, all right, I want to have the surface of it be like the paperiness of my mother's skin. That's where I started. Now, where it ended up was way away from that, but it set up a dialogue initially for where I was thinking. But I have never really been interested or able or found a good balance between that sort of telling what I mean and then bringing a life of the sort of currency of how the work evolves. I do think, that this notion of bridging and mapping and interconnectivity and industrialization and fragility, all of those adjectives, if you will, or verbs are in the work. But if I started with my mother's skin, that started with fragility, but I guess my full intention for the piece wasn't that, or it didn't make sense to me to continue to make the piece about that. Now, am I evading the question? I don't know, but I mean, that Speak English piece that I had in the museum, that was, I held on to that content all the way through, and that was about this teaching of English as a language, and that was probably the most overt in terms of my subject intention. But did I keep going with that? No, I think I'm much more interested in this kind of visual relationship I have with these building blocks that I'm using and trying to keep a sensibility to the work without it having to be only about that, or that's what you read first. I don't know, does that make any sense?
It does, but can I follow up and just say with both of you, I understand you're not trying to make socially political specific content-based work, but at the same time, what I'm curious about is not so much where you started from thinking of it, but like in your case, when you talk about the pieces, you talk about the experiences and the things in life that are within the work that evolve from the work in the process. And what I was curious about was, in the end, you want your viewers thinking about those narratives and those stories or is it just that part of what feeds your process? And with him, I mean, I understand in a similar way that, you know, especially the standalone sculptures that were more figurative, but say the stick piece, just the choice of materials of the sticks in relationship to how you're fastening them and how you're hanging them, those opposing materials, are they something that you're thinking about?
The effort was to alter this space that we're in and to change its the way that people move through it. As they come up out of the stairs, as they make their way around to be with these sculptures, as they make their way to look at Cathy's work. And the way that the chlorophyll in the bark of the moose wood continues to kind of glow indoors, even in the middle of winter, is interesting to me. The contrast with the stainless steel cable, the Colin made a key contribution to this piece when he offered me these sash weights, which come, you know, from the sides of old houses where the windows were double hung windows, and the extra tension that puts on the piece. So the fact that there's this natural material which extends back and forth, held in tension with a very man-made taut aircraft cable, held in place by an antique sash weight. Yeah, that's all part of what I want people to think about. If they observe that and they get engaged in that, then that's what I want.
Admiring your sculptures and standing up here and seeing the flux playing on them, I'm taken by the way in which it's a novel way of doing a grayscale value study. Those are quite apart from the interesting shapes, and I wondered there, as a painter as well as a sculptor, whether that was a conscious
Well, you know what I liked? It's really interesting what you say, because the tar reflects light almost the way patent leather does, and it sort of is either all black or all white. There's a kind of high contrast quality to it, because when the light isn't reflecting it, it absorbs light pretty completely, and yet it sparkles and glints. You know, the nature of that is kind of glaze-like, but it's different than ceramic glaze in that it has a kind of constant fluidity to it. I mean, I guess that's not quite true, because glaze is a frozen moment of fluidity. You know, when you fire something, the glaze is in motion, and then as it cools, that motion is arrested. And some of that is happening with the tar, too. But it would be a real challenge. You know, I'm thinking of Janet Fish, who does such beautiful paintings of reflective surfaces, and you know that ability to see into a high contrast situation, in her case glass most often, would be an interesting challenge to try and do something like that, to draw or paint one of these guys. You know, there's something that's kind of wonderful and entertaining and also kind of awful about that surface. And I was kind of attracted to that tension between something which is attractive and something which is kind of a little off, a little disgusting.
Do you dip the pieces?
Dip them, yeah, dip them in. And then they have to be hung for quite a long time because the stuff runs off. And then they have to be kind of kept away from people like Cathy, who is sensitive to the off-gassing of them. I hope they haven't been off-gassing too badly here in your gallery.
When I walked into the gallery several days ago, my take on it was that this was a singular piece.
Mm-hmm.
And it doesn't sound as if that was your intent.
Well, you know, I had hopes that it might be. You know, what I was hoping was that the natural and lively quality of these beautiful nature-made lines would contrast with the industrial waste quality of the roofing tar and the sculptures and make a kind of nature man contrast, nature human dynamic. And so, and you know, even as early as late as this morning, I was thinking of bringing some extra ones of these and laying them so that they came out this way, and you know, to let those two situations be more integrated. So I wish that I could have gotten the right way to unify these two, because it was in my mind to try it. But I think they're kind of coincident rather than collaborators, these two pieces at the moment. I wish that I had sorted out exactly how to make them really unify. But I'm glad you can see that the possibility is there.
My feeling is that you did.
Yeah. I mean, did what I say match up with what you were thinking about them?
I mean, I would find the addition of the branches on the ground overly little.
Yeah.
So I'm glad you did.
Okay.
For what then?
Well, they were closer over here to begin with. They were in close. And then it ended up looking like this was just a backdrop, more like, you know, a bamboo curtain that you hang in the doorway. So I moved them away. So I don't know. I guess you never know what's going to work and what's not. Thank you for thinking of them as unified, because it wasn't my mind to make them unified. I think I kind of failed at that, though. My own feeling is that I did.
I mean, there's something that, like you said, that there's an indication of the natural weight and gravity and movement of figures moving within some sort of landscape here, but that there's sort of an industrialization or commercialism or materialism kind of superimposed on them, which is, I feel, like sort of flipped in this sculpture, where the natural aspect of the materials is much more in the forefront, and yet they're hung with an industrial material and in a way which is unnatural to them. And so I feel like they speak to each other just in the materials.
I made things out of wax for a long time, and the wax sculptures that I made were real dust magnets. You know, they never really, wax maintains its softness on a warm day, no matter what. And this stuff is going to be a real, so I'm sort of fearful what will happen to these over time. They're probably going to end up, I don't know if you guys know about this, one of the only impressionist sculptors, a guy named Medardo Rosso made these beautiful plaster head sculptures, and then he dipped them in wax. They were just beautiful beeswax coatings on plaster sculpture, and the light would enter in through the wax and then bounce back. And almost all of them, except for the ones that were kept in vitrines, have ended up to be like collections of every bit of dust that fell between 1880 and the present. So I'm afraid that may be the fate of these things. Maybe I can take a torch to them later and redo it. I don't know. But it doesn't matter, I guess. That something will happen to them. they'd be tough to own, I think, maybe.
I was interested in what you talked about with your mother's skin as a beginning. And then, you know, you shot off to just list of what it's become, mapping all kinds of bridge. And all of that I see in it. And I wonder, as you're looking around at them now, if you're connected with that idea of maybe mapping, of this aerial view of looking down on the earth with this chaos, that very controlled chaos that you've given us. And if when you get that kind of clarity, how does that inform what you're going to do next?
I think, you know, having the work up with, you know, older piece and then pieces that are just finished, it gives me an opportunity to kind of think about my process and where it began, which was here, with, you know, maybe five pieces after this one. And then I think, in looking at this now, I think some of that which is happening here is more interesting to me than these later ones, where I've isolated it down to perhaps a more narrow use of vocabulary. Now, does that say what the subject of it will be? I'm not sure, but I think I'm feeling some tug towards a certain more painterly quality in the work rather than limiting myself to cut and tear. Now, I have work going in the studio now that is leaping away from all of this in these very open, gridded pieces with no foundation under them at all. So that's more coming off of that piece there where I'm using that networking grid, but leaving the kind of background surface, and can I isolate it down to some of those shapes? It's a kind of mystery, I think, on how I find a new kind of location for myself. And it's tenuous, and I feel very tenuous right now in the studio because I don't know, you know, and so I'm just going back to what Bud said, I'm just making raw material and kind of mucking around and putting a lot of things up on the wall, and we'll start to recombine. I used sewing patterns for a long time, but I would take it down to just the diagrammatic information on it. And I still am really interested in those sewing pattern shapes. So I keep coming back to trying to use them, and then like my mother's skin, I abandon it because it has so much content, you know, relative to domesticity and sewing and the shape of the body and all of that, that then I run screaming when I get too close to it being obvious. But I keep inching back towards that. So I do, I mean, this is kind of kimono-like, right? There's a kind of quality of a dress pattern, it's decorative, that interests me as well, but that's pretty content-laden, right? Of the dress, the costume. So I'm a nervous Nelly, I guess, when I get too close to a certain content, and it's maybe my own failings, you know, to move away from that. Being an abstract painter for a long time, if I get too close to it being readable, then I, you know, no. So it could be my own old history that's chasing me around.
I'm wondering, I guess, when you're making the work, what are you imagining the audience is intended for, or was displayed, how it would be received? Is that informing your work?
What Cathy was saying earlier about having had the luxury of living in teaching environments for most of our careers as artists, you know, is the audience also bound up in that community for us as it is today? You know, you guys are all involved in either our teaching environment or the one that's here. Is that the ideal viewer? Is the ideal viewer in a commercial relationship to the work? Is there a sort of art historical eye that comes to the, I don't think too much about it other than to say I'm glad that there is any audience at all for the work, frankly, because it's not easy to find one, and having the good fortune of having interested people around us, I don't know. We held an open studio this fall. It was in late August or
September.
Early September. And just, you know, it's an annual event. People come driving through. They're leaf peeping in New England. And they come into our studios, and it's a really different audience, a really different take. And I sort of am interested when that happens to see. It's not a gallery-going audience. It's not a museum-going audience. It's not an educational environment audience. It's just people out for a drive who see a sign and say, oh, let's go in there. And talking to them, getting, you know, without saying too much, just having them experience, look around, see what's going on. I'm interested in them, too. I mean, I'm interested in, but I just don't get a chance to put the work in front of people who are more diverse, more outside of the world of art making, or not having a whole introduction to it. I just don't get a chance very often. I wish I had more chances, actually, because I think that would be interesting to me.
You know, I think about audience because I work in such big scale, and that kind of makes me feel bad, you know, that they are so big and need a certain amount of space to be seen in. That seems kind of indulgent sometimes, but it's what I'm comfortable with now, and I like the something that's as big as me or bigger. That does put pressure on where they get seen too, you know. I really hope, like Tim said, that people can come into the work with a certain commonality to what I intended, but also with lots of range of associations, you know. And like Tim said, that seems really important.
As a writer, as a poet, I was just thinking, I had a poem that started with a friend dying and Pleiades showers were on, and I said the Pleiades showers, and suddenly it was the tar on the road underneath the car tire that became important, you know, that shift. And I don't even know how I shifted, but mm-hmm. I was just curious, Tim, since you're writing, or, you know, Cathy talked about it, did you find that process of your writing too?
There's a wonderful short essay by Ben Shawn called The Shape of Content, and how, you know, he begins with this very urgent need to illustrate this event, this fire, that, you know, devastating fire, and how the image, you know, shifts radically away from the illustration of that idea into something else. Sorry, I interrupted you. You weren't finished. Oh, it's unpredictable, but... And I think every artist has a different strategy for it, you know, where some are able to be very direct in bringing that idea forward, but I am not that direct. I really do meander and have always been somebody who destroys things in order to find meaning in them. And it's kind of a dumb way to work, but it's just, going too far, losing it completely, and then rebuilding, and that time spent with the work connects me to the work very deeply. And so that's a historic thing. It's the way that I've kind of formed myself as an artist. And so the layering that happens then takes time, and then my relationship to it shifts as well a lot.
You know, it's such an interesting thing, because in some ways we both feel a little dinosaurish. Because we are artists who are more visually driven rather than artists who are more intellectually driven. There is such a victory of conceptualism in the visual art world these days that artists like Cathy and I, who's at least, you know, neither of us would describe ourselves as formalists, I don't think. I think because we're after something that isn't simply about form as content. But at the same time, we're visually driven people. We want these experiences to have content and meaning through a visual language, right? The language of form that is animate, that is full of possibility, of interpretation, but not driven by a conceit, a particular conceptual strategy. And that places us strictly in a kind of old-fashioned relationship to contemporanea, I'm afraid. Because so much of the contemporary art world is driven by conceit. And sometimes we find ourselves quite mournful about the fate of artists whose strategies are more visually driven. So, I mean, I love that work. I mean, I'm not resentful, really, against any of that. Because I find it very interesting, and in fact, has made the art world grow up in many ways from a kind of self-satisfied optical, as Duchamp would say, relationship to the world. But at the same time, we still believe in making things that are visually potent and that you all, as an audience, can make sense of without overburdening them with concept. Now, that may be going a little far. I don't know. What do you think?
Yeah, I think it also just talks to our history. You know, I'm a product of abstract expressionism. I mean, I love that stuff, you know. It still informs my vocabulary, the way I work.
When John asked the question before about how the materials and the forms interact with their implications. I think I tried to answer in a way that showed that I think about that stuff too. And I think, you know, we do think about that a lot. We don't avoid that in our own work. It's just that we don't want to let that be the guiding principle of the work, if there's an inherent conflict in there, it'd be interesting to play that out, but I hope not.
Yeah, I think I could go through every one of these and sort of talk about my choices and then why I chose to use what I did, but whether it's first and foremost, I mean, the top of the corner of that one, I was trying to make a brick wall on the red, right? I was stamping, you know, chunks of wood, dipping them in ink and making bricks because I wanted to have a brick wall. And yes, I used paper, I didn't use bricks. But I did want that sensibility of it being brick. Now that got buried beneath the structuring of it, but I'm still using paper. Paper is my material of choice right now, and why I like its transparency, I like its translucency, I like that I can rip it, I can print it. So the practical side of the paper is very specific in how it takes ink and other suggestions. I'm using white glue, it's the most cheap. I like using white glue. These are not archival. They're really very temporary, if you will. So I feel like I could go through and be, I don't know, I'm sounding really defensive now, be pretty specific to the materials that I'm using. This was all wallpaper that Martina and I printed at a workshop, and I've struggled to use it, but I tried to kind of make a wallpaper decorative, something that related to how wallpaper might find its way into a form. So, you know, I think that it's there, you know, the raffia, the netting, you know, is there and butterfly nets, but it's maybe not right out in front, right? But it still makes me nervous. Like, what am I doing using, you know, string here, you know? What does that have to do with anything? And sometimes nothing. So then I take it off and get all nervous, but then I'll put it back on because I like how it looks. So, you know, it's a little bit of a game of hearing my own words chattering away in my head that I say to you guys.
And I think both of us spend tremendous energy trying to sort out what that content is. It just, we just don't like to lay that out as the as a kind of manifesto. Yeah. Thank you all for coming. I appreciate all your questions.